start at this stage. Am I easy to change your name to those of you who are not from St. Hugh's? And a very warm welcome to St. Hugh's and to the China Centre Lecture Theatre. And this is the first of our series of academic lectures for this term, and I'm delighted to introduce to you all Dr. Michael Holland. Instead of mice, in the Oxford Journal on French Studies, that there are few more impressive examples of single-minded dedication in the face of intimidating difficulty than the attention that Michael Holland, over a period of more than 40 years, has paid to writings of Mice Long Show. Those types of observations and comments are not at all restricted. It's something that's been reinforced in my few years here, the degree of respect that he's held in. It's our great regret that he's decided to retire. I'm hoping it'll be the type of retirement that we experienced with our senior tutor, Roy Westbrook, who retired in August and was back in October. Barely time to put his feet up. But certainly he has been with this college and not as proud of his work. Mike was appointed tutor in French to St. Hugh's in 1986. His main research area is, as mentioned, the work of modern scholarship. But more generally, he encompasses an interest in French literature and thought from 1848 onwards, and French politics since 1870. In addition, he has completed research in the field of avant-garde theatre since the late 19th century, from Jacques and Mallarmé to Jean Nesco. I think that's correct. Near enough. Mike is someone who just managed to scrape a hire in French in Scotland. Two handicaps here. Mike was one of the first scholars to study Longshow in depth, publishing the first comprehensive bibliography of his work in 1975. After completing his thesis in 1982, he went on to write numerous studies of aspects of Longshow's work in both English and French. His Longshow Reader presented a range of writings from the 1930s to the 1990s to English-speaking readers, with an introduction to each section of the book. He's currently published three volumes of a four-volume translation of Longshow's wartime writings with Fordham University, and most recently he published Avant-Dire, a collection of Longshow essays, and it was published in January 2015, again to critical acclaim. This evening, Mike is going to lecture us on our inner stage, outrageous antics in French theatre. Thank you very much. Thanks.
In the traditional New York extract from his diary in the LRB this January, Alan Bennett observed in passing that Samuel Beckett neglects the body in his plays. How does Winnie shit? Winnie, remind you, is the woman in Happy Days buried up to her waist and an act two up to her neck in the ground. Now this displays a fundamental misunderstanding on Alan Bennett's part, not just of Beckett's theatre, but of the whole theatre tradition out of which it arises. I'm referring to the so-called avant-garde tradition in modern theatre, whose origins lie predominantly in France. At the same time, I'd say that in Beckett's case, Alan Bennett is also right, though right for the wrong reasons. He's wrong to say that Beckett neglects the body in his plays. From Waiting for Godot on, Beckett's theatre presents characters who are weighed down by their bodies, trapped by their afflictions and their disabilities. At the end of Waiting for Godot, Vladimir says, "Well, should we go?" Estrella replies, "Yes, let's go." The stage direction reads, "They do not move." And everything that happens in the play and in subsequent plays by Beckett bears the marks of his paralyzed physical state. So Beckett's theatre certainly does involve the body, but it does so by treating the body as a burden, which is basically what 2,000 years or so of Christian culture have done. So rather than neglect the body as Alan Bennett claims, what Beckett neglects is what the body has become in theatre, and I would say partly thanks to theatre, since the extraordinary moment at the end of the 19th century in France when theatre gained a new lease of life. It's that moment and its aftermath that I want to talk to you about this evening. Don't get me wrong, I've got nothing against Beckett as a dramatist, but in my view, Beckett is a playwright who betrays the avant-garde tradition he belongs to by presenting the body as something inert and disabling. And this explains his immense popularity. He damps down and renders palatable, or at least assimilable, something bodily which, when it first emerges in modern theatre, is highly unsettling. If Beckett's remain popular, therefore, it's because he does the very familiar containment job of letting something shocking and disruptive into the sphere of art and providing a means of keeping it in check. His enormous popularity, even among people with never seen his plays, overshadows the tradition that emerges from and effectively, sorry, the tradition that emerges from and effectively neutralizes its influence. And if I've shocked you a tiny bit by what I've said about Beckett, it's because my subject today is precisely shock, a tradition of shock. And to trace this tradition to its source, we have to go back nearly 150 years to the last decade of the 19th century, when shock first became a fully-fledged artistic principle. But initially, it isn't to a playwright that I want to turn, but to a poet, Stéphane Mallarmé. Though Mallarmé was a poet, he was also very interested in theatre. He was even a theatre critic for a while, sometimes for the National Observer in London. But he rarely went to the theatre. Like most literary people at the time, he felt that theatre as an art form was moribund. In the 1880s and 90s, the theatre either put on plays for the edification of the new upper class, the bourgeoisie, or staged the repertoire in an increasingly ponderous and over-elaborate way, so that the stage became, as it were, clogged up with artificial echo and stage effect. Now, there are interesting reasons for this development. Much fin de siècle art was driven by a powerful urge to capture the increasingly diverse and dynamic reality of contemporary life as directly as possible. If this was the kiss of death for theatre, it was simply because of the insuperable artificiality of the stage. Attempts by Zola and other naturalists to put their novels on the stage proved lamentable failure. It wasn't that the ambition was wrong, art was trying to keep abreast of the changes of the time. But putting too much reality on the stage simply prevents the stage from functioning dramatically. A theatre of real life, therefore, proved an unrealizable project, and it looked as if theatre had had its day. And in one last struggle to keep theatre for art, the theatre once again became the site of an artistic battle. The symbolists tried to reclaim the stage from the naturalists by getting rid of props and scenery altogether and reducing action and the presence of actors to a minimum. In an attempt to present audiences with as direct an experience as possible of the pure, unchanging truth of things that lies beyond the physical world, but most of their efforts were a fiasco. An attempt to convey the sensuous splendor of the biblical Song of Songs by wafting perfume across the audience disrupted the performance by giving the front rows an uncontrollable coughing. This, like other similar attempts, was much ridiculed in the present time. It was clear that the alternative to naturalism was just as incompatible with the stage as naturalism was. Theatre at the time was facing, therefore, an inextricable dilemma. On the one hand, hijacked by the dominant class, was no longer really an art form, more a sort of social therapy. On the other hand, it was being fought over by two diametrically opposed artistic movements, neither of which could really do anything with the stage, which, let's remember, is simply a box with one side. Now, the simple response to this for many people was, don't go to the theatre, even if you're a theatre critic. Stay at home and read the play. But then Mallarmé had a brainwave, one which, without exaggeration, can be said to have caught the tide of the fundamental changes that people in society were going through at the time. And his brainwave was this: theatre doesn't happen out there, in the box, on the material stage. It happens in here, on what he calls the inner stage of our mind. Now, we can see better now why he didn't feel the need to go to the theatre. A book is enough to prize open our inner stage. And he went on, there's a theatre inherent in the mind. Everybody carries an inner theatre about with them all the time. Now, that might have been a pretty weak idea. Rather like saying each of us has a home cinema in our heads, so we can curl up, close our eyes, and let its images flicker across our minds when we fancy. And understood out that way, theatre would be merely an extension of the bourgeois individualism that was driving art out. Mallarmé's idea is much more complex and exciting than that. Our inner stage doesn't just allow us to turn away from the outer stage. In doing so, it recasts the basic relation between us and the stage. And that is a relationship founded on distance. Stage and audience are separate from each other, kept apart by the impossible border formed by the footlights. And to understand Mallarmé's idea better, we can read what he says about Shakespeare in one of his pieces of theatre criticism. I'll read the translation in English. Lear, he says, Hamlet himself, Cordelia, Ophelia, all of them remote and distant, in that special distance that legend provides, are active in every life, tangibly and intensely. When we read, they crumple the page and surge up bodily in us. I'd read the French for that. Lu, il froisse la page pour surgir corporel en nous. It's that image of crumpling the page is what I wanted to know. What he's saying is that when we read a Shakespeare play, rather than attend the heavy costume drama version found in contemporary theatre, the play isn't projected onto an imaginary replica of the outer stage existing in miniature in our heads. We don't see the play in our heads, we feel it physically. It doesn't flicker across our minds, it invades our bodies. Our bodies are our inner stage. The magnificent image of these characters crumpling the page and surging up inside our bodies completely renews our understanding of what the stage is once we've discovered the existence of the inner stage. Here, the stage isn't something we look at with the distance that presupposes, it's something we feel with an immediacy and intensity. The distance is abolished. The special distance in which all these legendary characters exist in us is therefore not the same as the distance that vision presupposes. It's a latency that's ready at any moment, as Proust later discovered when he dips a madeleine in a cup of tea, to rush forth and engulf our entire conscious being. But in that case, if Shakespeare's characters exist as archetypes latent in each, why don't his plays just bring them to mind for us as we read? If recalling them overwhelms our minds with bodily experience, according to Carmen, what sense do they make? And if it's the case that modern theatre unleashes our bodies so that they invade our minds, doesn't Beckett actually do us all a favour by reducing human bodies to passive burdens in the theatre? Well, to answer these questions, we have to take a brief look at the intellectual context within which Mallarmé's use of the term stage occurs. A lot of 20th century art and thought was, and still is, condemned for being miserable, negative, decadent, evil, in short, for denying basic human values, for being nihilistic. Whenever such condemnation has been heard, it has often included the writer that negative art, or negative thought, is responsible for the way these values are denied. But the truth is that modern art, far from being part of the problem, is a search for a solution. Let's take Beckett again. He once said that his basic ambition as a writer was to give confusion shape. And let's be clear, in saying that, he isn't admitting to being the cause of the confusion, even though audiences even today may well think that he is. The confusion is already there. Modernity itself, in its broadest social and cultural sense, is essentially in a state of confusion, which is to say a loss of all certainty. This means that the more a work of art embraces confusion within the form, keeps its shape, the closer it may be getting to overcoming confusion, or at least making it tractable. But why are we so confused? Confusion is a loss of bearings, of orientation. Something fundamental has collapsed, and everything runs into everything else. As we say nowadays, it's a loss of boundaries. It's a pretty claustrophobic state to be in. There's no sense of distance, swamped, overwhelmed. In his 1938 novel, Nausea, Jean-Paul Sartre depicted this experience of being swamped by amorphous matter in the episode where his hero stares at a tree and feels it invading his body. Those who began to think about this confusion or respond to it through art realized something crucial. However easily we may feel confused as things close in on us or get on top of us, the source of our confusion is not an excess of things that don't add up anymore. If we're confused, it's because something has happened to nothing, to what nothing means and is for our minds. Now, I can't go into this in detail, and perhaps it's getting a bit abstruse, but it would get too technical. But European modernity, the era that began with the French Revolution, which remains our era, yes, in the first Brits, comes of age with the discovery that nothing is the ultimate reality of the highest plan. And nothing has, of course, always been around, in the form of the abyss, the void, the bottomless pit, etc. More to the point, nothing is something each and every one of us makes use of every time we think practically about the world. For example, you see some pieces of wood, you say, they would make a nice table. You use them to make the table. What could be more ordinary, more real? But in the process, your mind so briefly does something terrifying. In order to imagine and project what the pieces of wood could be, a table, we briefly have to blank out the world, to annihilate it momentarily. That amazing power is something we're so accustomed to we don't even notice it. But it is what separates us absolutely from animals, even those capable of building elaborate structures. They do so because they've evolved that way, they just do it. We do so because we can decide to obliterate, suspend our perception, use our imagination to replace one version of the world with another one, and so progressively make reality conform to our new image of it. So nothing is no big deal. It's been around basically for as long as humans have. In fact, it's probably the most essentially human thing about us. Until recently, if we humans thought about nothing, we did so within a frame of understanding and belief. Belief either in God or in the human absolute, which has effectively substituted itself for God in Western modernity. In short, thinking about nothing always presupposed a belief in something. But from the second half of the 19th century onwards, in Europe and particularly in France, a deep conviction took hold that neither a transcendent nor an idea of human progress could any longer provide a framework within which one could make sense of living in the world. Two pages. This is a very broad brush account, and of course the conviction I'm talking about was of no doubt direct concern to most people. Only those usually self-appointed special individuals we call artists, musicians, philosophers, whom we allow to influence our lives. In short, it was primarily a cultural issue. And what we observe when we pay attention at the cultural level is not just, as I said, a turning away from the ideal represented by God or his substitute man, but a massive shift in the role and reality of nothing. And I'll say again, culture is not responsible for this shift, it's acutely sensitive to it. Right into the second half of the 19th century, today, for all practical purposes, nothing continues to be equated with an absence of void, an abyss, a chasm, etc. And in the 19th century, a poet like Baudelaire seems to prolong that vision when he evokes his fear of what he calls vast black nothingness, or néant, vaste noir. But in fact, Baudelaire's poetry is the site of a profound mutation in what nothing means in our experience and culture. Because in fact, Baudelaire no longer considers nothing simply as an absence. Anticipating Nietzsche, he thinks that humans strive either towards something as an absolute or towards nothing as an absolute. But when the striving stops, and that's what modernity encounters in the late 19th century as a new and alarming possibility, when the striving stops, when the future closes down, so you find yourself confined to the present moment, perched precariously on the top of a pile of all the present moments that are now past and gone, then to encounter nothing isn't to find yourself staring into a void, but to feel that you're being engulfed by the material world, your mind incapable of propelling itself into the future, retrieving the past, and invaded by the sheer physicality of sensation. Remember Sartre's nausea? And the German writer Walter Benjamin, in his book Berlin and Childhood in 1928, shows up the limitations of Proust's understanding of this experience physicality, when he writes the following: we can never fully regain the past. Fortunately, perhaps, the shock of the reunion would be so disruptive that we would immediately stop being able to understand our nostalgia. Henceforth, for Baudelaire and his posterity, what is therefore more negative than nothing considered as an infinite void is nothing as limitless matter. Each of them infinitely overflows the individual mind. But what had long done so in the form of distance, remoteness, nothing was always distant, now did so as proximity, as forced intimacy. No thing is not an absence, it's the disappearance of proportion and perspective which make matter into a thing. Nothing is therefore matter in the raw. Now Mallarmé, the successor to Baudelaire, takes this new perspective further. I should say it's a perspective I'm feeding to you in the raw this way. I could give you chapter and verse in great detail as a change in view. I've got to get on to the theatres now. So Mallarmé is the successor to Baudelaire, and he takes this perspective I've been describing schematically further. Initially terrified, as Baudelaire was, by the abyss that nothingness traditionally opens up, especially when we've taken away any certainty of God, Mallarmé, as it were, saw through it. He saw that nothingness is infinite emptiness, is nothing but an invention of the mind, a last-ditch effort to protect the mind's requirement that something should ultimately be there, that what is true and real be something, even if it's no thing. And he resorted to a familiar pattern to express his initial encounter with that. It was a version of Dante's descent into the inferno. But the way he uses the Dante model reveals it has ceased to function as it usually does. I've encountered nothing, he wrote to a friend. Sheer sensation has destroyed every frame within which my mind seeks to survive. I've descended into the abyss. His encounter with nothing, in other words, an overwhelming of mind by bodily sensation. But then he goes on, I have returned. Poetry has shown me a way beyond the annihilating encounter with nothingness. But then comes the catch. I'm Dante, he says in effect, which means I am my Beatrice. But, writes Mallarmé to his friend, destruction was my Beatrice. The destruction that sensation wreaked on his mind, driving it into the hell of nothingness is the same power, he says, that allows him to return from it. So it's only by espousing, destruction absolutely, the young Mallarmé realizes, the paralyzing obsession of nothing that has invaded modern times will give way to something creative, livable, and human, but on condition that destruction remains absolute. In other words, destruction and creation are henceforth inseparable, indistinguishable, coextensive. There's no alternation, there's no dialectic. All at all times are active. Sorry, both at all times are active. One happens within the other. Now, I've pushed this argument to the point where it becomes a sterile paradox in tension, because that's precisely where it inevitably leads if you continue to approach it using the thinking mind alone. But Mallarmé isn't primarily a thinker, he's a poet. Of course, poets can be listened to, they're conveniently sidelined as non-serious, but Mallarmé is more than a poet, because he's discovered that when the body, as it were, blows the mind, this doesn't leave individuals in a state resembling psychosis, that is to say, a loss of contact with reality, and it doesn't do so because our minds have an independent facility or dimension where the body's destructive force can be experienced creatively. A dimension he calls, as we saw, our inner stage, a theatre inherent in the mind. Rather like the discovery of the unconscious, which Sigmund Freud would call another stage, ein anderer Schauplatz, but more interesting in my view, Mallarmé's inner stage is the site of a non-rational, but as such coherent and human activity. In other words, when Lear, Hamlet, and Cordelia surge up bodily in us when we read Shakespeare, they don't just blank out our minds with our bodies, they unseat our minds, dislodge them from the exclusive control of our conscious faculty by showing that while the mind is sovereign in its own domain, that of reason, the version of nothing it has proposed for centuries is a fiction, a figment, a screen, and a lid designed to prevent the other dimension of our existence from ever entering our conscious minds, because the argument of reason goes, it can only disrupt our minds and drive us to perdition. But now that perdition at this time was increasingly being seen as what humanity was facing, nihilism in a nutshell, Mallarmé's discovery of an inner stage offers a lifeline. Yes, If the body sensation simply invades the rational mind, its effects will be unpredictable and almost certainly negative, as Walter Benjamin saw. But if the body is allowed to invade the mind on its own state, the mind will cease to be exclusively under the control of reason, but it won't sink into chaos and confusion, because the newly demoted but still fully functional dimension of reason will coexist with our bodies as they play out their effects on our inner stage. Now, this could be no more than a cosmic parallel, but that would presuppose that the rational mind, with its limits and proportions, remain in control. But it isn't anymore. If the inner stage allows an unleashing of those forces which swamp reason, this points to the possibility of a new way of thinking, even in the modern era, which isn't exclusively rational. A way of thinking which accepts the reality of nothing as the invasion of reason by the body, acquiesces in the need for reason to be suspended, but has found a way of operating from beyond both reason and its eclipse by sensation, from a third position, really, as I say, which we'll articulate. In short, a way of thinking that has discovered a new relation to reason. Now, this marks the beginning of a new phase in the human adventure at this time. All modern art and theatre in its own way has been a search for a language in which two sorts of human expression can exist productively. And since it began in the 19th century, this search hasn't been an easy one. One thing is certain, no persecution, no war, no actual destruction has ever been wreaked by painters, poets, or musicians during that period, however convinced they were of nothingness. Nor have the great calamities of the modern era ever been carried out in the name of the values that artists pursued, even if they are essentially negative. Now, today I'd like to look at three moments in theatre's exploration of this new field. Each of the plays I look at offers what I just call, and I call again, a new articulation of the mind-body relation, using articulation to mean coherent expression, but also, and primarily, simply as a linking joint, a hinge between two separate dimensions. The first play I'm going to talk to you about is one you may know of, Ubu Hua. It ran for all of one night on the 10th of December 1896, and it changed the face of modern theatre entirely, saving it, as many have said, from stagnation and eventual disappearance. Disappearance as an artistic medium, that is, distinct from a mode of entertainment. Now, the reason the play was taken off after one night is because it was utterly scandalous. After much wheedling and cajoling, Jarry had persuaded the Paris theatre owner to stage his play. Jarry came out in front of the curtain before it began, completely drunk on absinthe, and tried to explain what the play was trying to do. He then staggered off, the curtain opened, and an even weirder figure staggered off the stage, gross, bloated, with a great mask on his head, and uttered one word, merde. Not merde, but merde. Cyril Connolly and Barbara White both translate as push it. Well, you can imagine the article. But there was more to come. Ubu is a king, his scepter an occasional weapon of choice is a toilet brush, which he forces people to taste. Before you finished your sandwiches, he invites guests to a dinner where shit is on the menu. Now, even by today's blasé standards, that's pretty revolting. And the audience was revolted. One critic wrote that after seeing the play, he needed to visit the cleaners. Many of Jarry's friends thought it couldn't possibly be serious, but he was. As we see, his creature, Ubu, was not just an infantile figure designed to defend, but infantile Ubu was in a very precise way. He wasn't Jarry's invention. At his school, there was a rather pompous physics teacher, Monsieur Hébert, and Jarry and his classmates spent ages amusing themselves by writing play after play, lampooning this figure, whose name gradually mutated from Iber to Eb to Ib to Ub, and finally to Ubu. So the play Jarry put on in 1896 was thus the fruit of a collective adolescent endeavor. In fact, one of his classmates unsuccessfully tried to sue Jarry for ownership. Recently, parenthesis, in a performance at the Playhouse, the director had the brainwave and cast a teenage boy who isn't one of Jan's characters, who did no more than observe the action from various vantage points on the stage. His presence a constant reminder of the perspective in which he grew up, should be viewed, and was originally written. So what people saw and heard on that December evening in 1896 was essentially the work of a bunch of smutty adolescents. And it's that which has come down to us as the play that rescued theatre from its decline and set it on a new modern path. How on earth, you may ask? Well, the key to this lies subtly in the opening word, merde. It's not just that the extra letter is superfluous semantically. By clouding the transparency of language, its superfluousness foregrounds that dimension of words that has to be forgotten, or at least dumbed down, if rational communication is to take place. You don't want to think about the form of what I'm saying to you, listening, trying to put a message. By clouding, as I say, it clouds the transparency of language, that physicality, which is present in poetry too, but is always exploited according to strict rituals. And that is the material nature of language, the fact that language isn't always, remains something that originates in our bodies. So the obscenity of merde doesn't just lie in the unmentionable nature of what the word refers to. It also lies in the way the word lets the body intrude into the communication process and keeps it there. Merde. Just like Lear, Cordelia, and the rest who surge up bodily in us, according to Mallarmé when we read Shakespeare, Ubu, as his very first word lets us know, will not just produce disgust in us, disgust being a way of keeping what's disgusting at a distance, that's the function of the disgust. He would disgustingly invade our bodies. Interestingly, Mallarmé loved Ubu. He wrote to Jarry to say he found his play to be in perfect taste. But more important than this acknowledgement that Jarry was doing more than just being offensive is something Jarry himself says about Ubu as a play. There is no point, he says, in unleashing a character of fiction onto a stage unless there are theatrical reasons for doing so. In other words, unless your character is intrinsically theatrical, you may as well present him in a book. So Jarry could be said to understand the role of the body in theatre exactly the way Mallarmé does. Unlike Mallarmé, he sees a role for the outer stage, whereas Mallarmé abandons it for the inner stage alone. And it's this difference of attitude that saves theatre from extinction at this time by enlisting the real outer stage in the cause of modern avant-garde art. Now, does this mean that the emergence of the inner stage, which is the subject of lecture, is just a passing phase confined to Mallarmé and his work? Well, not at all. Though Jarry insists on the role of the outer stage in anything that calls itself theatre, this is the better to open up and exploit what Mallarmé calls the inner stage in us. When a stage character surges up bodily in us, Jarry wants this not just to be a matter of language, but to involve a real stage. He doesn't want to bring to life archetypes of human existence from work from authors in the past. He wants to remind us what is basest about our bodies and do it itself here and now in front of an audience. Inevitably, though, we have to ask the question, what is progressive avant-garde, let alone artistic in any way, about exposing an audience to revolting on-stage behavior? The shock effect may briefly make something surge up in us, but any audience will inevitably retreat from this either by leaving the theatre as it did or by recoiling mentally in disgust. At this stage, it's hard to see how Jarry is extending and fulfilling Mallarmé's idea of theatre as an inner stage. But here is where we encounter Jarry's true originality, even his genius, I'd say. There is more, much more to who you are than the antics of its abominable hero. Because like Mallarmé, Jarry also draws on Shakespeare in composing his play. The action and the setting of Ubu are provided predominantly by Macbeth, to some extent by Julius Caesar, with elements of Falstaff, the figure of Falstaff thrown in. And the overall plot, though schematic, clearly and coherently recalls not just Shakespeare, but the whole tradition of the history play and indeed history itself, where kings and pretenders struggle for power. Now, leaving aside the detail of all that, what it means is when you go and see Ubu performed, not one but two stages are involved. The outer one, where a familiar drama is being acted out, and the inner one, where the play is acting on your body. These two stages are inextricably linked. Your attention is firmly focused outwards, but the more you look out from your seat at the familiar space and the stage and the action it contains, the more you experience something happening on the inner stage of your body because of you being disgusting. Of course, you could say that's nothing new. When encountered on the outer stage, Lear, Cordelia, and all the rest surge up inside us in a way bodily as well as mentally. That's the way to work. But let's remember Mallarmé's image of the crumpled page. It suggested metaphorically the abolition of a boundary. That when what is out there surges up in here, our entire sense of in as distinct from out is momentarily obliterated. What Jarry's development and Mallarmé's perspective allows us to consider is that this blanking out doesn't happen as an either-or experience. In Jarry, that process is happening every moment. Throughout the play, you're simultaneously observing a recognizable action on an outer stage and experiencing an upsurge of something bodily on your inner stage. Not alternately, which is more or less conceivable, but simultaneously, which isn't, unless you revise your understanding how you're put together as a conscious being. Throughout the performance of Ubu, while the audience is therefore suspended in the state of being focused by their minds on the action out there on the stage and overwhelmed by their bodies as something surging up uncontrollably in them, as disgust. They are both at a distance from reality and submerged by reality. That's the originality of Ubu and the reason why it marks a new departure for theatre. Not its obscenity, but what the shock of the obscenity introduces into the audience's perception, the sense of an unthinkable but intensely real experience of being simultaneously drawn outwards and driven inwards, and so made the sight of such an extreme divergence that it's tantamount to a break, a hiatus, a discontinuity in our consciousness of self. Now, something Jarry says about setting in his play illustrates this, and here Jarry is quite a precursor. He recommends something we're very used to now, from school plays to serious theatre. Detailed setting, he said, is superfluous. It appeals to weak minds. For him, the Polish army is adequately represented by a soldier with a placard around his neck saying, Polish army. Just as a man on horseback simply needs a cardboard horse's head around his neck to signify that. Now, Jarry's reason for this is very new, in modernity, is what should interest us. Scene changes, he said, only matter at the moment of change, at the point of transition between one scene or one act and the other. The content of the scene, therefore, is just a formality. Polish army, blasted heat. The play's focus is entirely on the difference between one scene and the other, on the point of change. So as we watch this crude, schematic but fully recognizable version of Shakespeare and the history play, its coherence encompasses within it a principle of absolute discontinuity, a moment of pure change, which Jarry explicitly says in this, which transforms the stage from being not just a container for a significant action, but also into being what I'm calling the articulation by which change is endlessly performed. And what turns such endless change from quickly becoming superficial and tiresome is that we are swept up in the process. We don't just observe this discontinuity at a distance. Ubu's obscenity overflows the footlights, surges up physically inside us on our inner stage as a gut reaction of disgust. In short, the ultimate focus of that discontinuity is us. The play is nothing other than the installation within us of the differential drive minds and bodies, as our focus outwards on familiar action coexists with the experience of being invaded bodily by the play. Now, this is more or less where Jarry left things. He wrote a few more Ubu plays, but Ubu Awa wasn't put on again after that first night until after his wretched death. He drank and starved himself to death, aged only 36. Famous last words were, "A toothpick." But art, like water, goes underground. The 19th century heaved into the 20th. The West exploded in World War I. And a figure as outlandish in his way as Jarry was making a name for himself. Guillaume Apollinaire, the illegitimate stateless son of an itinerant Polish countess who became one of the 20th century's greatest poets. He also wrote a single memorable play in which he picks up the baton that Jarry had let fall. A play also set to music. Francis Poulenc, I haven't got him there, but he reminds me, in 1947. The play was The Breasts of Tiresias, Les Mamelles de Tiresias, which was put on again for a single night on the 24th of June, 1917. Now, like Jarry's play, Tiresias uses the stage in a new and original way. And like Jarry's play, it shocked people by the physicality of what it presented. But unlike in Jarry's play, the body is present not as the gut. Tiresias is a play about love and sex, the exuberant, life-giving, liberating part of sex. It's also set in Zanzibar and takes issue with the colonial imperial suppression of time. Therese, the heroine, declares she's a feminist, 1970, who's tired of being a second-class citizen. She decides to change sex and become Tiresias. In mythology, Tiresias is turned into a woman for 7 years for hitting some copulating snakes. Therese therefore opens her blouse, releases her breasts, which are balloons on strings, make them bounce like that, and pops them with a lighter. When her husband tries to stop her, she beats him up, undresses, and changes clothes with them, then goes off to become head of the army. Two characters unrelated to the cat as the action rush onto the stage fighting a duel. This attracts a gendarme. He sees the husband in a dress and starts to flirt with him. They agree to have children together, since all women have followed Therese's example, like Eli Sistrata, and refuse to have sex. And that's the end of Act 1. In Act 2, procreation has occurred. The stage direction reads, "Babies crying and libertine." The husband says he's given birth to 40,049 children in a single day, and the plot more or less grinds to a halt there. The rest consisting of a series of verbal and scenic gags with nods and winks to friends and in the direction of political events. Finally, Therese, as Tiresias, returns, throws off her disguise and says she can't do without love. But her husband finds her too flat-chested and tries to stuff balls and balloons back down her blouse. She resists and bombards the audience with the balls. The play closes with a dance and a song whose words sum up what the play's been trying to do. Love the white or else the black. It's much more fun when things change. All you have to do is notice it. Now, the exuberant vitality of the play must be obvious, as is its bold engagement with sexuality and racial prejudice. The scene where Therese's breasts pop out is both shocking in 1917, where Ubu's marital was, but also playful and light-hearted in the way Jarry never is. Once released into the sphere of action, the vital urge, which in Ubu is unremittingly base, not only operates to creative effect, whereas in Jarry it's destructive, it's presented as a source of communication between people, whereas Ubu is an absolutely separate, isolated figure. But what about the inner stage? Well, let's look at the outer stage first. It doesn't keep our attention focused the way Ubu Awa did by creating a recognizable plot. It does so rather by being a succession of gags, stunts, and scenic hijinks. The people of Zanzibar are played by a single actor who sits on stage and produces the various bizarre sound effects with equipment whenever required. When Therese decides to leave home, she throws a number of objects out of the window at her husband. First, a chamber pot. And he cries, "The piano." Then a mason, "Oh, the violin." Then a urinal, "Oh, the butter dish." Now, a shade of Jarry here, but a reminder, no doubt, that a couple of months before, Marcel Duchamp's work entitled Fountain, which was in fact a urinal, had been refused by the Society of Independent Artists in New York. Now, all this exuberance recalls two things. Dada performance, which I shan't go into, which began in the Cabaret Voltaire in Zurich in 1916. And in Paris, Jean Cocteau's ballet, Parade, I read it from the same year. But though Tiresias is even more exuberant and chaotic than Parade, its effect and Apollinaire's aims go much further. Diaghilev had said to Cocteau, astonish me, and that's what Cocteau did. With the help of Picasso, Eric Satie, and Diaghilev's own company, Parade bombards the audience with astonishing and unexpected effects. But surprise wears thin, and Parade was a seven-day wonder. Tiresias surprises its audience, even shocks them from time to time. But what Apollinaire calls the new aesthetic he was seeking to found lies not in the direction of shock alone, but in the direction in which Jarry first drew theatre, which Mallarmé foresaw, namely the replacement of the safe distance between stage and audience with a mobile division which subjects the audience to an experience of liberating and disruptive change. For Apollinaire, this was the only way to convert the sheer destructive energy of individuals' bodily urges into a mode of exchange he called love. But that conversion was only possible if individuals allowed themselves to be perpetually open to change and remained aware of it, conscious of it. Remember the song, things are better when they change, all you need to do is be aware of it. It's in that spirit we should respond to the series of mismatched names and objects I quoted. They're not just zany tomfoolery. As for Jarry, they make the outer stage the site of a disconnection between objects and language. And as Jarry said about scene changes, what's important is the difference, the moment of change. But Apollinaire's main contribution to helping theatre become such a mode of interactive communication is one we're blasé about since the heyday of the Roundhouse and Chalk Farm, and that is his recommendation in the prologue to Tiresias that his play be put on not using an old-style stage, but in, I quote, a round theatre with two stages, one in the middle, one forming a sort of ring around the audience, allowing full development of our modern art. So a center stage and a stage running behind the audience, which would, as it were, sweep them up in things. Now this was such a new idea that he was unable to realize it practically in play. Nonetheless, all of the elements of Jarry's innovation are present. Bodily frisson, a dislodging of the limits separating mind and body works from reality, theater in its new aesthetic, considered ultimately not just a spectacle, but as an operation that uses spectacle and the shock it can deliver to offer a new articulation between things that are different. A new articulation in both senses is what I said, the play acting as a linking hinge between opposites such as white and black, male and female, and expressing that articulation in a way that the mind can be aware of, but which language alone is incapable of. Now for the third example, last example of what I'm talking about, we move to the post-First World War era, the 1920s. Surrealism is in the ascendant. But strange to say, surrealism produced no lasting theatrical works. So when the current of theatre again resurfaces in this period, it's a renegade from the surrealist movement, one of many who was responsible. Antonin Artaud, one of the most original theatrical minds in the period. Along with one or two others, he decided to found the Alfred Jarry Theatre in 1927, whose aim, as Jarry stated, was to pursue what Jarry had made possible in the theatre. The Alfred Jarry Theatre was an ephemeral institution. It had no theatre of its own and relied on using venues on dates when they'd otherwise be closed. It only staged four plays, which ran over six nights, and the last one of these was called Victor, or Children in Power, by a young unknown called Roger Vitrac. The play ran for one night, once again, Christmas Eve, 1928. It's about a birthday held by a bourgeois couple for their son Victor, who is nine, to which his parents have invited a girl of his age, Esther, and her parents. Victor is played by an adult. Anticipating Dennis Potter's 1979 play, some of you may remember Blue Remembered Hills. Victor dies on his ninth birthday at the end of the play, at the precise moment would be like when life is revealed to him as it really is. Because life in this bourgeois milieu is going to be presented as something powerfully destructive. To convey this, the play borrows the by now totally hackneyed charm of the bourgeois family drama. The outer stage is thus present in its most familiar guise in Victor. And as spectators, we are taken deeper and deeper into the intimacy of what it portrays. And what we see is that life, that force that Apollinaire sought to tap for its creativity, is once again, as with Javi, totally destructive. Love, celebrated so joyfully and innocently in Tiresias, is reduced to its familiar theatrical version, adultery. Victor's father Charles and Emily's mother, who's called Thérèse, are lovers. Thérèse's husband Antoine is balmy, lost in a world of military humiliation dating from the Franco-Prussian War, while Charles' wife Emily is just too dim to notice what's going on. In short, the play mimes, exaggerates and parodies, then pushes ad absurdum the bourgeois family drama in order to prevent it totally solid. Love between adults by deception, and love between parents and children by violence. Esther is repeatedly being slapped by her mother. For the first time on his birthday, Victor is slapped by his father, and this culminates in a dreadful scene in Act 3. Victor knocks on his parents' bedroom door. He has a stomach ache, as we see the gut plays a role in this play too. Charles drags him off, and we hear offstage the violent sounds of Victor being. The rest of the scene is conducted with Victor's sobs and groans audible from offstage. And after this, violence slowly begins to invade the play. Victor asks a general, who's also a guest, to let him ride in like a horse and whip his backside. Esther has a fit and foams at the mouth. Antoine hangs himself from the balcony of the flat, and Charles holds a revolver to his wife's head and threatens to kill her. As a critic wrote the next day, Wittag's play brings the audience to an unbearable pitch of excitability. The life we look at, while on one level utterly recognizable at the time, is invaded and invades the audience with an increasing frenzy whose violence we respond to painfully with our bodies. We look on aghast as the lively, wicked and disruptive infant Victor is eventually crushed by the repressed and repressive society we born into. The play is, at this level, an utterly depressing spectacle. As an audience, we can only feel increasingly repelled and isolated from what society portrays, while at the same time seeing it as our society, since much of what we see still goes on. I should say the play has been on in Paris recently for two successive years. And then something happens, and it reveals the true lineage of the play, turning it from being a piece of miserabilist, even nihilistic social commentary typical of the gloom of the interwar years into a worthy successor to both Javi and Apollinaire, enriching and humanizing what Javi revealed while maintaining the baseness that Apollinaire rises above. And here's what happens. In the middle of the play, an unexpected character who has nothing whatsoever to do with the action wanders onto the stage. She's a tall, serenely beautiful woman called Ida Mortimer. She's on a visit to a friend, and it turns out she's got the wrong house. So you see, in plot terms, her presence in the play is totally unmotivated. What is more, the idealized perfection of her physical beauty is designed to contrast starkly with the human ugliness emerging on the stage. But she's going to interfere in the action in two ways, one of which makes sense in terms of what's going on, while the other does not. First, she sits Victor on her lap, and at his request, whispers the sexual facts of life to him in a scene which is, even as you imagine, is an uncomfortable one for the audience and is acted so as to maximize the discomfort. At this level of her intervention, it's made clear at the dawn of the new Freudian age that the life force represented by the nine-year-old Victor, which family and society violently repress, is sexual in nature. At this point, Ida, the outsider, is thus integrated into the play. As it's developing, she makes sense. But before this, in the previous scene, her presence has had an entirely different effect. As she's politely apologizing for having disturbed the party by mistake, the stage direction reads, bruit postérieur incongru. incongruous posterior noises. In other words, she begins to fart. And she goes on, farting and farting and farting in an unstoppable volley of sound, apologizing profusely over and over again. Now this lasts for some considerable time. The audience inevitably is surprised and shocked and ultimately bursts out laughing. Clearly, as with Jeanne, they find themselves responding both to what's going on out there on the stage as action, but also to something going on in them. But what surges up physically in the audience is more complex than Jeanne's case, because Ida is both incontinent and sexually desirable. Our body's response to her flatulence is thus itself the site of a division between attraction and repulsion. So though we maintain a residual perspective on what is going on in the outer stage, because Ida is totally external to the action shifts more or less entirely to our inner stage at this point. But in this case, our bodies don't just surge up. In doing so, they themselves become the site of a division between two sorts of bodily impulse, desire and repugnance. In short, what surges up bodily in us is a conflict, a split, a divide. And what I call theatre as pure articulation, really incompatible opposites, has for the first time materialized on our inner stage. And as if to mark this fact, Witak's play does something quite remarkable at this point. When Ida starts to fight and the audience bursts out laughing, the stage direction says that all of the characters on stage must also burst out laughing. The play is thus effectively suspended at this point. Another spectacle has interrupted it. And here's Witak's originality. The stage direction also reads, the actors must only stop laughing when the audience has. In other words, briefly but decisively, the entire dramatic setup was altered. Actors and audience together have become the combined audience for the sublimely grotesque spectacle. Momentarily deprived of their focus on the outer stage, since the actors also become spectators, the real audience is left exposed, momentarily but enduringly, to the pure dramatic articulation that Ida Mortmout has brought onto their inner stage. I realize talking about all that in a lecture is absurd because it's only really perceptible in plays. And what we're perceiving in this art, even though it's 150 years that it's been going on now, is the beginnings, a searching for this new articulation between body and mind. There's nothing definitive, but simply to indicate, to conclude, that it's not just historically, it keeps going on. I'd like to just refer to two plays running at the moment, one in Paris and one in London. In Paris, Coltès's play, The Solitude of the Cotton Fields, that's the Solitude de Chagny de Coton, which was written in 1985, is on in Paris in a very interesting production. The audience has headphones and hears what there are two characters in it, a dealer and buyer, drug dealer and buyer. But I mean, they're the reason for a sort of long exploration of interpersonal relations. The audience hears through headphones. The auditorium is completely fogged. You can scarcely see a thing. The characters wander about among the audience as they speak, but the audience hears it through their headphones. There's a complete rejig of the relation between audience and play. There's a crossing of the footlights, and given the nature and the intense violence of the play, you get a very interesting interaction, which seems to me to be, to throw back to what I'm saying. The second one is a little less extreme, but it's on in London at the minute, the Royal Court. Carol Church's newest play, Escaped Alone, in which four 70-ish ladies sit in one of their gardens and chat about this and that. One of them, however, didn't play by Linda Bassett, the lights change, suddenly becomes a Cassandra figure, and back projected there are pictures of catastrophes and cannibalism, all sorts of the horrors that humanity is capable of. There again, it seems to me, and this is what the critics are, you're getting a shift of frame, two theatres being used. One, very familiar, intentionally very comforting, satisfying to see four people, just elderly people having a chat. but suddenly it jerking itself towards another stage in time. It's still going on. I hope I've given you some inklings of where it started. Thank you very much.